everyone, this is Devlina welcoming you all to another action-packed episode of Icons Behind Brand video interview series Marketing Today and Tomorrow, where we are going to talk with some of the preeminent marketing minds of the business. And today I'm super excited to announce our guest. On today's episode, I have a guest whom I know from quite some time, a highly professional, super energetic and a dynamic personality with over 11 years in the field of brand and marketing. She has worked with various MNCs in different industries, from food to oil and gas to FMCG domain. I welcome Ms. Srijita Chatterjee, who is leading brand and communication for Shell India. A warm welcome to you, Srijita.
Hi. Hi, Devlina. How are you?
I'm doing very good, Srijita. How are you?
Good as well. As good as I can be on a Sunday.
So. Yes. And thank you for your time on Sunday afternoon. Happy to have you here, finally. Over 11 years of experience in the field of marketing, brand and communication. Yeah. How was your journey been, Srijita? And tell us more about your background too.
Sure. So it's been quite a journey. To be honest, when I started off, I did not really know whether I'll be able to land myself in marketing finally, because as you must also be aware that as we start as management trainees, we are not given a specific profile, we are not given a specific training like that. We are rotated across functions in the organization so that we ourselves find some space or something that we're good at, and vice versa, the organization also sees your skills through that process, right? So I started as a management trainee with Everity Industries, and it being an FMCG brand, it was quite interesting to go through the stints. In the process, somewhere I realized maybe I like sales. Yeah. Okay. And when I was approached for a role in marketing, I actually was a little bit disappointed, thinking, okay, will I be good at marketing because I'm doing sales really well, and maybe I should pursue that. But it was my a mentor from that organization that I'm still in touch with, and he is actually told me that no, I honestly genuinely should groom yourself as a marketing individual. Here I am. So that's where it started, and till date I think I look up to him as well for guidance and advice, so on and so forth. Apart from that, professionally, after Everity I was there for about 3 years. After that I moved to VIP Industries, so that's travel and lifestyle goods. From there, I moved on to QSR with one of the leading brands in the industry. Don't know if you've heard about Burger King, but I worked there.
Yes.
I worked with the team, which was part of the launching team for the brand in the country. It was super exciting. It was a startup environment, and the learning was phenomenal over there. I mean, in that period of time, I had the most precious amount of learning as an individual, as a professional. And finally, now I'm working with Shell Mobility. I lead the brand and communications piece for them in the company. So that's about it. That's been my journey as a professional. And yeah, I'm so far, I think I'm still learning. And I intend to keep learning. So that's my mindset towards my career ahead.
That's right. A lifelong learning process, right? And your journey is super exciting, Srijita, like starting from, FMCG to food to
travel
to finally, oil and lubricant domain. It's like a complete wide range of industries you have worked on.
Correct.
So currently, Srijita, who are your target customers, and what kind of campaigns do you do to reach out to your target customers?
So the thing is, it's interesting because across industries I've worked with multiple audiences, and it's like I said, it's about targeting a specific kind of mindset and reaching out, not even so much targeting as it is reaching out and building relevance, right? Because people will not buy you if they don't. I mean, it's classic marketing advice, but yeah, it's true. if they don't see themselves or identify with you or what you're saying, they will not buy your product. In most cases, I've seen people don't buy the product so much as much as they buy into the philosophy of the brand or why the brand exists. So as long as they see that relevance, they see their lives changing in a positive way because of the impact of the organization or the brand, they will keep buying with you, because it's not a transaction that we are looking at converting. It's a long-term association that we want with the customer. So in that sense, we cater to different kinds of audiences. We cater to different kinds of customers, because mobility, currently in the industry that I'm in, which is mobility.
Yeah, I think that's again a great point, that it's a constant event. You just cannot define with one single, you know, framework that this is my target customer and just stop and keep targeting that, because you just have to reinvent again and again about your target customer based on the based on the occasion, based on the requirement, because the target customer, when it is huge, you just have to, you know, narrow it down with that. One and a half years we all have, you know, gone through with turbulence, you know, in the market during the pandemic time. So what were your major roadblocks, during last 1 year, and how did you overcome with that, Srijita?
So as a marketer or as a communications professional, the first few months were pretty tough, in the sense that not because, technology had changed, not because there was any constraint around the way that we would market, but it's just that what I felt was understanding customer behavior at that point was very difficult, because this was a first for everyone. In the last century, no one had ever seen anything which was as vast as this, as far-reaching as this, which is across the globe. It's not even a country level event or impact, right? So it took everyone by surprise. I mean, me, if I look at myself as a consumer, I had no way to understand what had happened and what next. So that whole what next part of it was very difficult to understand. And if you don't know, in a normal business as usual kind of an environment, you have data to back you. You look at past trends and then you can easily see a pattern and then predict somehow that, okay, this is what probably will work in the next quarter and the next year. But this was something very different. So understanding customer behavior is probably the most challenging thing that I experienced during the onset of the pandemic. Understanding their mental state was very difficult, because there was no way, there was no research, there was no data. We kept looking at past, what had happened, how did society come out of it and stuff like that. And I never thought that I would have to refer to something which was like as old as the Spanish flu to understand, or the Great Depression, to understand how people react and what are those triggers for people during times of crisis. So, and what does it mean in the modern world, right? Because the modern world as a whole, they don't think they've gone through such a big event, right? But that, I think, was the biggest challenge for me as a communications person. Nonetheless, it was important that we kept the conversation going.
I really loved the way you took it, Srijita, here. So, during that time, you might have, gone through with a different customer behavior. As you said, customer behavior was one of the most confusing part as a human being and as a business professional also. So,
yes,
customer insights that took you by surprise that particular time, and how are you using them to your business strategy?
Sure. Good question, because one was access to insights was pretty, it was not as easy as it is in a normal time. because of two things. Of course, executional challenges. So you could not really, when there was a full-blown lockdown going on, you could not have deployed, qualitative researches, etc., etc. So the executional hurdles were obviously there. But despite that, there were some good insights available from looking at, the patterns from the past and data. So, without data, there is no marketing, there is no research insight. But what we discovered or what we looked at and what I felt was a little bit of a different insight than what I would have seen in a normal time is that generally, people always want to know what is new, right? People are always obsessed with whatever is new, be it the newest technology, be it the newest, film, be it the newest series, the memes, the trends, the reels, all of that, right? Everyone's obsessed with whatever is new, whatever is trending. But during those peak, moments in the lockdown or in the pandemic itself, I think people went back to what was familiar.
Mm-hmm.
And people did not want to know what is new because at that point, new meant something negative. So people wanted to go back to whatever was familiar. People became grateful and thankful for whatever is familiar. They wanted that sense of normalcy. They did not want the extraordinary. And that for me was the biggest insight or learning as a marketer, as a professional, as a human. We did not want in Maslow's hierarchy, when we talk about the pyramid, I think people went back to belonging, people went back to the basic necessities, right? They went back to the basics. They did not want the self-actualization or the higher level of Maslow's hierarchy, right?
Right, right.
So I think that was one insight which was, and being in marketing, being in the field where everything runs on what is new and trending, I think it was a good insight or again a good moment to think about the fact that people wanted that sense of familiarity, wanted whatever they had rather than knowing whatever is new or whatever is trending. Of course, having said that, reels and Instagrammers and TikTokers, influencers, all of them, it become very big. But having said that, the core insight, like I mentioned, was that people wanted familiarity, people wanted that sense of belonging, people wanted that sense of normalcy. So that was, I think, during the time, that was one of the biggest learnings for me.
I think it's a very minute observation, Srijita, as you said, that people's mind are very, keen towards knowing new and going towards the new thing, and at the time of uncertainty, at the time of confusion, all of a sudden, we realize that we don't want anything new, we just want what we know already and what we are comfortable with. So I think that option has not yet come till now in my platform, so it's a great added here. And I also look back and I realized the same thing has happened that time. And as a marketer, we have been told that only look for the trends, look for the new things, and that shift in the consumer behavior and the same shift has to come to the marketing team has been a challenging time for everyone, I'm sure, right? So how do you make marketing as a growth of engine, especially at the tough times like this, when the when the cuts are deep and budgets are very tight?
That's again, something that it's not so much, I would say, a matter of cutting or being tight. It's a time for being efficient. So the point is around efficiency here. The point isn't around how much do you have and versus last year, versus the year before that, or what percentage of sales, etc., etc. Like I said, it was a time when nothing was standard, right? Mm-hmm. So you did not know whether you will need more budget or you will need less budget or whether you will need any budget at all, because even not talking to people was a completely acceptable thing to do. You give them time to get over this and then you probably reach out because you give them that breathing time to recover from what's going on. So it wasn't a matter so much of, I would say, cuts. It wasn't so much a matter or a decision of whether we had the resources or whether, you know, the organization felt a certain way or not. But I think it was a matter of prioritization. It was a matter of efficiency, you know, really. Because when we realized that, yes, we need to keep the conversation going, and that as a, I was really glad to have been, you know, part of that, you know, that process. And, I had really supportive colleagues and team members who appreciated the fact that, yes, we should not stop the communication. We should not stop, you know, talking. Because there are, you know, there are people who want to listen, who want to see, who want to understand what brands are doing. They wanted to know if we were being responsible enough. They wanted to know whether, like I mentioned earlier, whether we are living up to our purpose or not. So this was the time during crisis that, you know, it's a test of one's character as well, right? Right. So it was not so much about, like I said, the cutting budget. So it was never, the conversation never was around, you know, reducing anything. It was about prioritizing something, or if we could repurpose something. So having that sense in place helped us, because during business as usual, like I said, customers will remember you for the work that you're doing.
Right. So I think to sum it up, it's more about your budget and spend. It's more about your actions and how thoughtful you are towards your customers' needs at that particular point of time, and how efficiently you use the opportunity given at that particular
time.
Along with that, Shijita, what principles do you rely upon during the toughest moment as a marketer?
So toughest moments as a marketer, see, the thing is, again, like I said, it's not really, it's all relative. What is tough to me could be very easy for someone else. What is, you know, tough for someone else could be very easy and naturally, you know, something that comes to me. But what I feel are my guiding principles as a professional is, as a marketer, rather than anything else, is that I always tend to go back to data. Because honestly speaking, without data and then kind of marrying it into insights, I think it needs to be a combination of both data and insights. You have to listen to your customers, understand what they are saying, rather than just kind of imposing yourself and saying that, okay, my customers don't know what they want until they see it. There are lots of brands which who have done that successfully, of course, but then again, me at the stage that I'm at right now and the amount of knowledge that I have, I think looking at data and backing it up with a lot of research is very important. Without that, I don't think there is, you know, much success beyond a point. So I think that is my first principle, and whoever comes to me for advice or whoever I get an opportunity to mentor, I tell them to go back to data and insights and seeing some pattern in whatever, you know, unrelated data points or occurrences or events. Something that seems superficially unrelated could be one of the reasons why something is happening the way that it is, right? So that's one principle that I keep telling people and I keep following myself. So data orientation, research mindedness is extremely important. The second thing that I always also kind of follow is being solution oriented, keeping your learner's mindset in place, okay? And the third bit being, thinking like a customer in that moment, understanding your customer the right way, doing a lot of, market visits, talking to people.
And I think, I mean, when you go on ground and talk to your customers in a real time, then you get the actual, need and desire of your customers at that particular time, and it's a great insights. Yeah, on paper and on our graphs and charts, there are things might be different, but when you go on field, you actually get the right information about them.
It validates as well when you see someone.
Right.
So even today, when I see someone at the airport or at the train station carrying the bag that I had launched at some point, I really get excited.
Satisfaction you get then, okay, I have worked day and night on this, and now this is where. This is what is magic now in the real world. So as we move towards the future of marketing, how does it look like for you? How does the marketing look like?
Right. So future of marketing, well, I'll also be hopefully a part of marketing when it evolves. And I myself hope to learn a lot before that and keep myself prepared. Of course, everyone's talking about digitization, everyone's talking about digital marketing and how that is the future of marketing. But somewhere I also, as an individual, have this strong belief that privacy is becoming a big concern for a lot of people. Therefore, as a marketer, I need to prepare myself to understand what are those, wherever I'm working 5 years from now, 10 years from now, I'm sure digital marketing is going to be there. But in whatever capacity that I can learn or I can understand where the conversation on privacy is going, is how I think I'll be better equipped as a as an individual, as a member of society, and be a part of that time, the way that marketing will be in a world where, you know, human data or individual data is not as easily accessible as it is probably today. It is quite possible in the near future, I feel, and this is my limited, with my limited knowledge and research, this is what I feel would be one of the areas to be aware of, because there will be at some point this, you know, rise of consciousness around what we are doing with the data. How are we, feeding that data into, say, the machines that we are, making progress into machine learning and AI and all of these avenues. So future of marketing has to consider all of it.
That's right. Good, Shijita, you have, you know, brought this particular point where we look forward the future of marketing in different ways, where we know that digital is, you know, overpowering and taking the center stage here. At the same time,
yeah,
also, you know, heard about a cookie-less future, and, you know,
yeah,
people are a lot more sensitive about sharing their data. They're not very comfortable with their data. They are uncomfortable for the data breaching. A lot of things happens, right? So I think marketers also should be very aware of this future, and, you know, should come up with something in a, you know, midway path, like full consent with some of the, you know, customization of agreement of the terms and conditions.
Yeah.
And that's how I think something will come up for sure. And point has to, you know, come out of this, and everyone should always keep that sensitivity towards data in their mind, you know. Right. That, Shijita, we are now moving towards a little lighter section, a very interesting section, which is a rapid fire round. What is leadership for you?
Commitment.
Right. What book you are planning to read in near future?
The Book of Living and Dying, the Tibetan Book of Living and Dying.
Who has been the greatest influence to you?
Professionally and personally. I think personally, I think of course my father, but as a professional, I think I've learned a lot from a lot of people. I look up to my cousin sister, my first cousin.
So what is the best thing that has happened to you this year?
I would be tempted to say that my workouts have become a little regular.
Early in the morning or late in the night? What kind of person you are?
Yeah, I'm not a morning person.
Creativity means to you?
finding a solution, but something that has an impact.
So what is an important life lesson for someone to learn?
Being content is very important. I'm not saying that by not being ambitious, that it's not a linear equation. It's not necessary that people who are contented are not ambitious.
So with that, we are out of the rapid fire round. Rita, I would love to know, your message to the aspiring brand managers. There are a lot of people from B schools who are going to teach it. So your message for them.
My message for them. Personally, professionally, one is that marketing is not all that glamorous as it's made to be. Marketing is not about the ad that you see at the end of the day. It's about the hard work and data and the numbers that go in the background that delivers that kind of creative excellence that you end up seeing. There's a lot of basic hard work and grunt work and elbow grease that you have to go through before you aspire to become a brand manager, senior brand manager, whatever, CMO, CA, whatever level that you're chasing. Comes with a lot of thorough detailing that goes in your building years. I don't know how much people appreciate this, but having an eye for detail, especially in the world of marketing, is extremely important. You cannot disregard even a small if you're not comfortable, always raise it, because at the end of the day in the world of digital marketing everything gets noticed that many times. Earlier you had a print coming in for one day and it goes out the next day, there's a new new newspaper coming in with a new ad, but in today's digital world everything stays there. Right, even 10 years from now, if you make a mistake and it goes out there, it stays there.
Yes.
So being detail oriented and meticulous is extremely important for anyone who is looking for a career in marketing, at least in the building or the formative years. Over time it becomes a habit. So I think that would be my message to people who are just starting out. And rest assured that it's not always as glamorous as it sounds like. It is a lot of late hours. It's a lot of, thinking on your feet. It's a lot of managing people because managing agencies and your internal stakeholders may not always be the best, equation, because there are these people who are core creative people, and then there are people who are, non-core, non-creative people as well. You see, how that transition is difficult. And you are the bridge for that. Yeah, you have to convert a sales problem to a creative problem, and then a creative solution to a sales solution. So you are basically a bridge between the two, almost non-complementary, halves. If you're lucky, you will be in an organization which understands creativity a lot and appreciates, and it's a marketing forward organization. But sometimes you might also be in an organization which is, which does not understand marketing quite as much. And in that scenario, it is your, it is going to be your responsibility to cater your solution in a way to them which seems useful. It's not about only what you think you feel or how you want to approach it. It's about how the organization is built, how they want to approach it, and then bring a solution which is feasible and palatable to them. So you are basically that bridge. So it's important to have that flexibility.
Yeah, so it's not always rosy. It's also, behind the scenes, you should be aware of where you are and what you are going to do. Great insights, amazing shares, and a lot of stories, throughout the conversation with you, Srijita. And I enjoyed it, and I'm sure our viewers are also going to enjoy a lot, along with a lot of learning, from the conversation. Yeah, so it was wonderful having you here, and finally we made it. And thank you so much for your time and valuable insights for the platform.
No problem. Thanks so much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Yes.